Okay. All right, good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to our service today. It's a bit overcast outside, but we are here. Praise the Lord. And thank you for coming this morning to join us in our worship and praise to God, our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Jenny is going to lead the first part of our service, and John is going to speak to us this morning. So let's pray as we start our service today. And so the scriptures say that we are to be still and know that God is God. So Lord, as we come at this time in this space, we ask that you will still our hearts, quiet our hearts from all the clamor of the world, from all the noise in our own souls. And so may we focus all of our undivided attention on you. Forget everything else around us, and even in us, and bring it all to you in our time of worship and praise. We ask that your Holy Spirit will come, empower us, inspire us, teach us, so that as we leave this space and scatter into the world, we will go in your power, in your might, to be salt and light in the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jenny.
Good morning, everyone. Okay, welcome to the 21st Sunday of the year. Okay, we shall begin with an open prayer. It's on your sheets and even on your phones. Okay, Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your own name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The psalm for today is Psalm 113. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, you his servants. Praise the name of the Lord. Let the name of the Lord be praised, both now and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to the place where it is set, the name of the Lord is to be praised. The Lord is exalted over all the nations, his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, the one who sits enthroned on high, who stoops down to look on the heavens and the earth? He raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes. He settles his childless woman in her home as a happy mother of children. Praise the Lord. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. We now have our first song, and be found in 153 of your songbooks, and also on the overhead.
Hallelujah.
be seated. We'll now come to our confession. Jesus said, "The greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is love your neighbor as yourself. Lord, have mercy." Let us take a few moments of silence to confess needs that are in our own hearts. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Let's say it together. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, words, and deeds. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, O God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confess, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay. We'll now have our next song, At the Cross, At the Cross.
Oh,
Amen. Praise God. Okay. We'll now have, take seat, please. We'll now have our first reading from Alicia.
Good morning, everyone. Today's reading will be taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, starting at verse 1. You know, brothers and sisters, that our visit was not without results. We had previously suffered and had been treated outrageously in Philippi, as you know. But with the help of our God, we dare to tell you his gospel in the face of strong opposition. For the appeal we make does not spring from error or impure motives, nor are we trying to trick you. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We are not trying to please people, but God who tests our hearts. You know we never use flattery, nor did we put on a mask to cover up greed. God is our witness. We were not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else, even though as apostles of Christ we could have asserted our authority. Instead, we were like young children among you. Just as a nursing mother cares for her children, so we cared for you. Because we loved you so much, we were delighted to share with you not only the gospel of our God, but our lives as well. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We now come to our collect for today. The collect goes like this. Grant, we beseech you, merciful Lord, to your faithful people pardon and peace, that they may be cleansed from all their sins and serve you with a quiet mind, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reign with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We'll have our next song, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace.
Make me a child.
when you're doing a lot of things, it takes a while to get one going. So our gospel reading is from Matthew 22, and beginning at verse 34. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question. Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. While the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them, what do you think about the Messiah? Whose son is he? The son of David, they replied. He said to them, how is it then that David, speaking by the Spirit, calls him Lord? For he says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If then David calls him Lord, how can he be his son? No one could say a word in reply. And from that day on, no one dared to ask him any more questions. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Amen. Please do take a seat for a moment. We're going to dismiss our children, and John is going to come and speak to us. Before we dismiss that, and I'm chuckling because Jesus amazes me every time I read him. But let's let our children out and our young people, and then listen to John. Lord, we thank you for our children and our young people. You have entrusted them to us, and we pray that you will help us to be good stewards of that trust. We pray for them as they go to hear the gospel in their own way. We pray that you will be with their teachers and those who lead, and grant them ears to hear, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Thank you. And John, come forward. Thank you, my daughter. You're much taller than I. Just
put out there in case anyone.
Yep.
Let's wait for people to go out.
You're much taller than I think.
So I think that's an amazing reading. For me, it's really, really important because it distills the law and the prophets into two short directives, want a better word, but or commandments. And when you think about Matthew 22, it starts actually with Jesus talking about a king and his son wanting to give a banquet and wanting to invite loads of people in. And I don't know whether you remember, but a lot of them didn't really want to come. And he then sends the servants out again, and they murder the servants. And then he sends his army to do away with them, and then he sends the servants out into the highway and byways. That's interesting, isn't it? And who do you think, when you think about who was doing the persecuting, who do you think that might have been? I think it might have been some of the established church, if you like, or Pharisees who murdered the prophets. And Jesus said that to them, didn't he, in his dialogue with them. Then what have we got? We've got that section from last week, where they ask, they try and trip Jesus up, and they have three goes at trying to trip him up. And I think Cornelius laughing at the end is very appropriate, but what actually happened was, shall we pay taxes to Caesar? And you've got the Herodians and the Pharisees. So the Herodians wanted people to pay taxes to Caesar, and the Pharisees hated that. So whichever way Jesus would have kind of, in a simple way, answered, he would have been in trouble. But of course, render to Caesar the things of Caesar, and to God the things of the gods. And then we move on, and the Sadducees, the other bunch, they have their go. You know, they talk about a lady who is married to a chap who dies, and then there are six more brothers, and they all die. So whose wife will she be in the resurrection? Trying to trip Jesus up again, trying to say there is no resurrection. So Jesus deals with that and explains that they don't really understand the scriptures or the power of God or what people will be like in the resurrection. So now, coming after those two, well, let's have a final go. Let's get him this time. If we ask him, you know, what's the most important commandment? Well, you know, there are 613 to choose from. And will he go for civil law? Will he go for ceremonial law? You've got to do the right things in the temple. Or will he pick one of the Ten Commandments? Then we can say, well, if he's picked that one, what about the others? But what's interesting is another expert in the law, in another part of the gospel, had said to Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus had said to him, and this is in Luke's gospel, well, how do you read the law? And how did he reply? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and love your neighbour as yourself. So it's not that the fact the teachers of the law weren't aware of this either, really. It was a bit of a kind of game they were playing with Jesus. So Jesus told them what we must all bear in mind, which is at the beginning of our service, which is a really good thing. Okay, and then you've got the section at the end where, you know, so who is the Messiah? Who is Jesus, basically? And then they want to say, oh, he's the son of David. And then you get that kind of, if you like, game, set and match, where Jesus says, okay, well, look, David called him Lord. So David called David called me Lord, indirectly. You know, that's what you can infer from this. And then they really can't answer. They've tried to trip him up three times, hasn't worked. But he has reminded them of what the fundamental question that was asked by the other teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Well, love God with your whole heart, love your neighbour as yourself. So that's kind of the background to all of that. But I was thinking it mightn't harm to think, you know, about the Ten Commandments here. So just briefly summarising them, have no other gods before me. Don't make any graven images. Don't misuse the Lord's name. Remember the Sabbath. There are four there that are about God. Love God with your whole heart. Covers all four and more. Because it doesn't only say they are kind of contained within it, but the commandments don't say how. They don't say with your whole heart. And then you've got six that are about your neighbour. Well, mum and dad, they're your neighbours, kind of, in a funny way. Don't murder, don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't lie or give false testimony, and don't covet. So it would have been impossible to choose one of those, but love your neighbour as yourself embraces all the six as well. So you've got the whole lot covered with a great summary. I think it's a good idea to think about the word love. And kind of one of my favourite passages that my mum read with me often and encouraged me to think about was 1 Corinthians 13. She always used to say to me, you know, people do all kinds of things in church, John. But in the end, what matters is, do they love each other? Do we love God? What is love? And that 1 Corinthians 13 passage, it does, doesn't it? It explains it. But there's a bit in it that says, it kind of tries to describe love. Love is patient Love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonour others. It's not self-seeking, it's not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. So that's the kind of love, supernatural love, that we want to have for God, with God. And it's funny, isn't it? Because if you thought about God designing and creating everything, the Creator created creatures, you and me, with the intention that we would love him and that we would love each other. And there's a description of what we mean by that love. So I'm having kind of gone through the scripture and how it fits together there, probably good to think about, so for us, what does that actually mean? Well, there's the bit in John's letter, 1 John 4:20, I'm sure you're all very familiar with this. How can you love God if you don't love people around you? If you've got the love of God in you, surely you would love other people around you. And in a way, if you do, it's an instance of love, you are loving someone. It's also evidence of your faith. And James talks a lot about that. So going on beyond that. So this is where it gets really difficult. And we've just said the confession. It's easy in one way, difficult in another. But I'm going to start with, it could be potentially very difficult. Then we can come to, what do we do about that? But imagine you loved your neighbour as yourself. Okay? I mean, really, really, really love your neighbour as yourself. Right? Okay? There's no qualms here. I mean, fully. Well, that is a very tricky thing to do. And so let me think about myself, or perhaps you as well. What do we want? I want food on the table. I want nice clothes. I want shelter where I can be in comfort. I want a wife. I want children. I want money to pay the bills. I want recognition. I want people to say, John is someone, he has a place in the world. I want friends. Okay, so I want all those things. I want to do well in my exams. Okay, you want to do well in your exams. Your friend here, he can't do this stuff very well. Are you going to concentrate on your exams? Are you going to stop and help him? But you want to do well in your exams. I've got to focus on my exams. But your friend needs help. Okay, if you loved your friend or your neighbour, not your friend, someone you meet who needs help, as you loved yourself, that gets tricky. So we wanted to talk about the Thessalonian church. You know, Paul, he talked about being like a mother caring amongst her children with the church, didn't he? He's very gentle. He didn't burden them. He earned his own bread. He loved them. And he says it wasn't without results. Now, if you read further in Thessalonians, it's almost like a model church in inverted commas. A bit tricky to say that, but you know what I mean? People were very loving. And so there's someone called Aristides, an Athenian philosopher who was a Christian apologist. And he kind of encountered this church, the Thessalonians, and he wrote about them to Emperor Hadrian. This is what he said. They love one another. They never fail to help widows. They save orphans from those who would hurt them. If they have something, they give freely to the person who has nothing. If they see a stranger, they take him home and are happy as though he were a real brother. They don't consider themselves brothers in the usual sense, but brothers instead through the Spirit of God. Powerful. That's a powerful church. That's what we, I mean, I experience love, a lot of love here, and that's what we want to be like. That's what churches ought to be like. And that is, isn't it? That's modelling, I think, loving God with your whole heart and loving your neighbour as yourself. But you see, treating a stranger as if he was your real brother, it's a kind of high standard. And we think about brothers and sisters in Gaza and Israel, don't we? The difficulty there, and if you love them, love your neighbour as yourself, what would the implications be? So the real question is, do we do these things for our neighbour in the same way and with the same intensity as we do them for ourselves? Do we make our self-seeking the measure of our self-giving? And in Romans, Paul says, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. So we can never have enough. We can never have enough love for other people. There's always an outstanding debt, Paul says. We have an outstanding debt to love. We can never say, oh, we've loved enough now, we can stop. Now we can just be self-centered. No. And Paul himself, reflecting upon all of this, kind of, you know, thought about the Ten Commandments. And, you know, I told you about the Tenth Commandment. The Tenth Commandment, don't covet. And the difficulty with the Tenth Commandment, and Paul says it slew him. He focuses just on the Tenth Commandment. It slew him. Why the Tenth Commandment? Why is that so hard? Because it talks about the attitude of the heart. And you might not murder anyone, not steal, not do all this other stuff. But in your heart, what do you think of your neighbour? Do you actually think about adultery or stealing or murder? What's going on in your heart? Do things just come into it? You might not actually do it. You might tell, I'm fine. But in the heart, things occur, things come in, and they're not always pure. And Paul said it slew him. He couldn't control the thoughts that came into his heart. And there was the civil war that he describes going on inside him, wasn't there? I do the things I don't want to do. So, St. Augustine thought about that. And he talked about disordered loves. Disordered loves. So the cause of our sinning, a big cause of our lack of love for our neighbour, is that we get things out of proportion. I love Dorothea. I love bicycling. And I love God. Okay? So what's the order there? What's really important? Could go terribly wrong. And what St. Augustine says is when things are disordered, then it's a form of idolatry. So very much as I love Dorothea, if I loved her more than God, she will become an idol to me. That will be wrong. And the effect of idolatry is disastrous. And that also, put God first, is the very first commandment. Make no graven images. It's the second, yeah? So we've got to have our loves in order. So we can't do all of this in our own strength. And Paul talks about that in Romans again. He talks about failing in the flesh and walking in the spirit. So if we're going to do this stuff, we need God's love in us. So kind of linking the loves together. If my self-seeking is after God because I've got my loves correctly ordered, then my self-giving is fueled by my love for God. And God is the fount of all love. So it's impossible without God to love your neighbour. And this is an important point I want to make is some people say, you know, Jesus, he was a moral teacher. and he had all these good ideas and he had nice laws, love your neighbour as yourself. If you stop there, you've forgotten the end of Matthew 22, where we talk about Jesus being God. You're focusing on him being a moral teacher. Also, you're going to try and do it in your own strength. You're going to try and love your neighbour as yourself. Where are you going to get the resources to do that? You're not. This is what Paul says. When he thought about the 10th commandment, it slew him. Then he goes on to say, I need God, I need to walk in the Spirit. So, let's think about this. As you long for food on your table, so long for food on your neighbour's table. As you want nice clothes for you, so want nice clothes for your neighbour. As you want a comfortable place to live, so want a comfortable place for your neighbour. As you want security and safety, friends, you want your life to count, you want to make good grades and good exam, have good exam results. As you want those things for yourself, want them for your neighbour. That's what this is all about. So, the only way to do that, as we've said, or to move towards that, is to love God with our whole heart and to have God's love in our lives through the Spirit to enable us. There's no way we could otherwise begin to consider doing it. But supposing we've got examples of great Christians, St. Francis of Assisi, who make us a channel of your peace, wonderful. But even St. Francis of Assisi, supposing he was in Italy ministering to the poor and he needed to help people, he got an hour to do that and five people appeared and they all needed an hour. How would he choose? Which person would he help? Couldn't necessarily help all of them. This happens to us, doesn't it? Needs arise and we've got to prioritise. It's difficult. What do you keep and what do you give away? If you gave everything away, literally everything away, you'd die. What do you keep and what do you give away? How do we interpret what might be good for someone? What's good for Tim? What's good? It's a matter of interpretation. I want to love him, but do I know what the right thing is? There's a fork in the road and I don't know which way to go. I have a time of sinfulness where I fail. I feel miserable. What do I do? Difficulties in life that we all face. In loving our neighbour. Some thoughts about what to do that I want you to take away with you. People are transformed by stories. Jesus uses stories in the Bible. We need in our hearts to reflect upon the life of Jesus, the death of Jesus, and the resurrection of Jesus. We need to think about God's love for us. Got the story of Abraham and Isaac. Stay thy hand. Abraham did not sacrifice Isaac. And we got the Old Testament law. But for the forgiveness of our sins, for the whole world to receive forgiveness, Jesus went up that mountain at the cost of his life. Jesus fulfilled the law and is the way to heaven. So we need to, my point number one, reflect upon that often, that Jesus paid for us at the cost of his life. And through faith in him, we can have his Spirit to enable us. We talk about coveting, That means desiring and investing a major part of your life in something. But what we should covet God's love. We should covet God. That's the only form of coveting that is right. Wanting God more than anything else. Wanting that love of God in our lives. That's where we should be. So focusing on that, that's love for God, thinking about that. That's my first point. But second point is, let's remember St. Francis. Make me a channel of your peace. Make me a channel of your love. Let's pray for that every day. Let's pray for God to make us a channel of his love. And we need to remember, when things go wrong, what did Paul say? Your grace is sufficient for me. So a simple trust in God when things go wrong, when we can't do things, when we fail, when we feel weak, God's grace is sufficient for us. And we need to be thorough in repenting of our sin. We need to be honest before God and try not to sin. Because if sin separates us from God, we don't have God's love, we can't love our neighbour. And we need to be good at receiving as well as giving. In that Thessalonian church, you need to receive as well as give. You need to receive from your neighbour as well as receiving from God. Let's think about those five things. So, reflecting upon God's sacrifice, coveting the love of God, number one. Asking, like St. Francis, for God to make us a channel of his peace. Remembering that God's grace is sufficient. Repenting of our sins. And being open to receive as well as give love from others. So will you make those five points a focus for you going forward, so that we, will I as well as you, shall we, will we, be able to love God better and love our neighbour as ourselves better through that? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for all the love shown in this church. Fill us with your love and help each one of us to be a channel of your love, to build up our neighbours and draw others to firm faith in you. Amen.
Praise God. Thank you, John, for that powerful reminder of love this morning. Loving God and loving our neighbour. Very lots of practical things to reflect on as we go, seeking to do both of those in our day, in our day-to-day lives. Very important. The fact is, none of us do this, not even 1% of the time, as we ought. And so really, it's our prayer. Really, it should be our prayer every day. Lord, let me love you more. May I love others, indeed, as we love ourselves. If we pray nothing else, that should be our prayer every day. Thank you. Then we're going to sing, Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God. Let's stand. 493. 493, let's stand. Thank you. We're going to declare our faith in God. If you do have the sheet, look at the sheet because it will come up on your screen. Let us declare our faith in God together. We believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. We believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion
of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Amen.
Please do take a seat and we will be led in our prayers. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this new day. We thank you for all the good things you surround us with, the beauty of the world and all you created. We are grateful and rest in your words of assurance, not to be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer, petition, and thanksgiving to present our request to you. Lord, please fill us with your Holy Spirit as we bring our needs to you in prayer this morning. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, our Heavenly Father, please receive our joyful praise and adoration, that through your divine mercy and kindness, we enjoy the privilege and freedom of worship. As we rejoice in this great opportunity, we lift up to you our brothers and sisters in Christ who are oppressed and marginalized, not only from the extremists, but by their own government. We pray for your protection, wisdom, and strength to enable them to remain strong in their belief despite the challenges they face. We pray that those who lost friends and family members, homes, and livelihood because of their faith may receive support in the midst of loss, assurance and hope despite the difficulties they face. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Almighty God, we praise and magnify your holy name, that your Son Jesus Christ came to the world and brought us peace, and commanded us to live in peace with one another. We continue to pray for your everlasting peace between Israel and Palestine, between Russia and Ukraine, and other places suffering from political and religious unrest. We pray for support and comfort to all those families who lost loved ones due to recent crisis. And we continue to pray for understanding and tolerance that will end discord, bitterness, and hatred among nations. We pray for when the weapons of war will turn out to be famine tools. We pray, Lord, when your kingdom will come and your will be done on earth. We thank you, Lord, for those who gave their life for world peace. And we'll continue to pray for your peace, that your peace will cover the world, and we will love our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Almighty God, we pray for our community where we live, work, and play, especially those covered by our parish. We pray that God will guide and protect them from harm, that those still in darkness may experience your light,
with family ties strengthened, broken homes rebuilt. We remember the old and infirm, with nobody to care for them, to those who are depressed and vulnerable, especially as the cold winter months set in. We pray that they may experience God's richness and His unending resources. We also pray for hope to the troubled mind and courage to the downhearted. Lord, in your mercy, gracious Father, fountain of love and life, we praise and thank you for all the organizations that help those who are in need. We remember our charity of the month, Macmillan Cancer Support, and all the other organizations that help children in need around the world. We pray that in your mighty power they will continue to have enough resources and support as they fight against poverty and inequality in the world. We pray, Lord, that in your blessings we will meet this year's target of Operation Christmas Child. May it continue to help those children experience love and care, and show awareness of your power and blessings to those who care for them. Lord, in your mercy, God of mercy, we bring before you those who are troubled in mind, body, and soul, remembering our friends and families who are not well. We pray for our church family members who are not with us today due to sickness, and all those who are on our prayer list. You bring them before you, Lord, for you have the power to cure all manner of sickness, physical, spiritual, and emotional sickness. We pray for your healing mercies on them. Comfort and reassure their families and friends. In Jesus' name we pray. Heavenly Father, please accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Comfort. We are going to stand and share the peace with one another now. So let's stand. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to Him through faith, heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. That, but you know, we do have the contactless, among other things, at the back there to receive your offering. And now we're going to receive that and pray. Grace. We don't want to miss any. Let us pray together the prayer at the bottom of page 2. Do use your sheet, because it won't come up on the screen. The young people are away this morning. So let's pray. Gracious God, for all you have given us, all you will give us, and all you will give us here and now, we offer you our thanks and praise. Bless this offering of our money and of ourselves to be used in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Well, I'm going to prepare the table for communion, and while I'm doing that, we can say, Jesus, remember me.
Do this in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. For the end of supper, taking a cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, may us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With the whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise, and we lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. And so Jesus taught us to call God our Father, and so in faith and trust we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Now that God, we take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Now that God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Now that God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. So join me with faith, receiving the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Jesus died for you. And feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. Amen. Of course, all are invited to come to the Lord's table to receive the food that he has prepared for us. If you are receiving, of course, you can receive in both kinds, as we say here. You can receive the bread and the wine, or you may receive just one kind, which is bread only. If you are not receiving the body and blood of the Lord, you may still come for a blessing, and we offer God's blessing upon you. While we are doing this, we will sing as well.
So let's pray and remember those we are praying for at the table of God's mercy this morning. First, let's remember those on our prayer, list in our own church family. So at the table of God's mercy, we want to remember our sister Doreen, Jean and Walter and Monica, Dion, Sue and Daisy and family, Veronica and Chester, Dolly and Desmond, Jean Murphy, Joanne, Pat and Ray, Pauline and her mom Daphne. We understand is in the hospital and in surgery, I think, this morning. And so we keep Daphne in our prayer, and of course Pauline and the family as well, and praying for God to bring healing and strength to our sister Daphne. Pray for Muriel, Brother David, Sumia Carla, Veronica, as she recovers from her surgery, Monica and her daughter Shella, Charity, my friend Pippa, who's undergoing chemo for cancer, Duke, Radcliffe and Pauline, Pauline, the wife of Radcliffe, who had a stroke some time ago. We pray for them, and also for Radcliffe's sister, who's also undergoing chemotherapy for breast cancer. We remember our Archdeacon Elwin, who's also undergoing therapy, treatment for cancer. We remember Mr. Gray, who is now in a nursing home. Andy, who was here this morning, and his wife, Anita. We remember our sister Luna, our sister Dorothy. And Dorothy is, of course, the mom of Iman. And she's not well at the moment. She's getting frailer and weaker. So we pray for our sister Dorothy. Our brother Noah, as he recovers from his surgery as well. And Jackie, and brother's sister-in-law, who's also recovering from surgery. And others that are in our hearts, in our family, and our circle of friends. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We continue to pray for peace in the Middle East. We pray for the situation between Israel and Palestine. We pray for the people of Gaza, and indeed the people of Israel, as they undergo this very difficult situation of war in their land. So we pray the prayer that the church has asked us to pray. Holy God, hear the cry of our hearts as we hold before you the people of the Holy Land. Be near those who have lost lives and loved ones, to be a sure rock to those who are in terror this day. We pray that through your spirit of wisdom and mercy, conflict may cease, and that the leaders of the nations may work together for peace and justice between Israel and Palestine. As you wept over Jerusalem, so we ask that you hear the prayers of those who weep today for your holy land and the people who live there. We ask this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we continue to pray for ourselves, even as we heard this morning, when we're called upon to love God and to love one another. We pray that God will give us the grace to do this, to love Him every day, to put Him first in all that we do, and to remember others. As we say, it's God first, others second, and ourselves last. And we pray that God will give us grace to do that in our lives every day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, in whose service lies perfect freedom, teach us to obey you with loving hearts and steadfast wills through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father of light, in whom is no change or shadow of turning, you give us every good and perfect gift, and have brought us to birth by your word of truth. May we be a living sign of that kingdom
where your whole creation will be made perfect. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And together we say the prayer of thanks. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
So before we finish this morning, this afternoon now, we are going to have some notices, and your notice sheets, there are a number of things on there. I just want to highlight the most important ones that we are thinking of. The Operation Christmas Child, of course, is progressing, and one of the things that I was reminded of last week is that we will need £5 for each box. We are hoping to fill at least 100 boxes. The £5 is for shipping and handling, you know. It's always that. You're always, when you buy things, shipping and handling comes in. And so they've asked us to contribute £5 for each box for that. If you can do that, that would be great. We would love and of course, every year we say, and just to also say, with the generosity of you every year has made me fill that £5. So I have no worry that we will do it. Just a reminder. This week, of course, we have a number of things on Friday coming. We have the young people's meeting and social here for all those young people age 18 to 35. So if you know any young people in that age group, do invite them to come out on Friday evening here. It's worship, fellowship, and food. So do invite them to come. On Saturday evening, now I've looked at the forecast, it looks like it's going to rain, but we, you know, rain never stops us from having bonfire and fireworks. So hopefully we'll be able to have our bonfire and fireworks at the rectory on Saturday evening at 7 o'clock. This is a tradition that's been going back for a very long time in this church. And we want to keep it going because it's a good time to come together, to have food. Of course, food is always good. And fireworks. And of course, we need pyrotechnicians to come and do the fire because I don't play with fire. So do come along. Bring some food, bring some fireworks as you come to share and to fellowship at the rectory on Friday and Saturday evening. Alright, so that's the main thing. I have a few things on the notice sheet that I want to just highlight. Newham Council gives some money to projects. We've done this here before, you know. They give money every so often. I don't know where they get these pots of money, but they do have it. And they give to projects that are community-based. Not church-based, but community-based. Things that may happen in the church, but primarily for the community. If you have some ideas that we can use, some of that money, do let us know, because we'd love it. But we always support the ones that do. And there are two that are up this year, and you have to vote for these things, and the number of votes they get will give them the money, okay? I mean, whatever they're asking for. So the Healing Cafe at St. John's, you know my connection to St. John's, and they are asking for some money for the Healing Cafe. If you've never been to the Healing Cafe, it's on a Tuesday afternoon at St. John's, and it's actually just an open space for people to come and have some tea and share and talk to someone, anybody who is there, and pray. If you have an issue, there's somebody there to pray with you and so on. It's been going on for years, and it's open to the community. It's not just for the church, it's open to the community. And so they're asking us to vote for them to receive some funding for this. And of course, faith in schools. Faith in Schools have a project called What's the Point? What's the Point Knife Crime Project? And it's all about helping young people to be aware of the knife crime in our community. It's a very important project. It's been going on now for a couple of years, and Faith in Schools needs some extra money for that funding. Again, applying to the local council for that. It's a very worthy cause. If you can, go online, put the link there, but just go online and search really on Newham Council and you'll find these things and vote for them because these are worthy causes. All right. A number of other things. Today is, of course, a gift day. Hold on. We do have a special envelope for gift day. There are two gift days that we have here in our parish. What's the purpose of the gift day? The gift day is to ask for something extra for the running of the church, for the parish. We don't have many fundraisings because whenever we put on fundraising, there's no fund that is raised, okay? Very little. So it's partly because of where we are, our location. You know, in property they say location, location is everything. And we are not on a high street, we are hidden away. And so unless, when we have all sorts of fundraising, very few people pass by or come. And so fundraising doesn't work for us as a church, as we've come to realize over the years. So what we ask you and your loved ones to give us something extra twice a year. We do it in the spring at April, and we do it at the end of October in the autumn. And so today is that day. It's been in the notices for a few weeks. But of course, if you haven't taken an envelope, you can bring it to next week, of course, the other week, and so on. But today is the official day for the gift day. And there are envelopes at the back that actually says gift day. Okay, and it goes into that for today. All right. Birthdays. Let's look at the birthdays. Birthdays. Now, I know this. I have Doreen here. Doreen, it's your birthday tomorrow? Yes? All right. So we're crossing out the birthday to you in a moment. And I understand Pearl, it's your birthday tomorrow as well. Yes. So praise God. Yes. Oh, sorry. Doreen and Pearl share the same day. Any other birthdays this week? Anne's birthday is on Thursday. And Thursday as well, so praise God, yes. And David Britton. Ah, John's son, is his birthday this week? 31st, on Tuesday, yeah, oh brilliant. Any others? Any others? We're going to sing happy birthday and pray for you, so let's do that. Yeah, no? Let's sing. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for these, our members, and indeed your children who are celebrating birthday this week. We pray, O Lord, for your special blessing upon them on this special day. We ask that you grant them extra grace, special grace for this day as they celebrate this day. And we pray for health and strength for many more birthdays. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I see somebody on there. It's, you guys are... Oh, okay. Ah, early. Okay. All right. Are there wedding anniversaries? I don't think there are any wedding anniversaries. So, I think that's it. Yes? We're going to sing our final hymn. Yeah. Oh, no. Oh, yes. Yes. Jeff is traveling. He told me, but I hadn't written it down. So, so Jeff, we're going to pray for you before you go. So, yes, anybody who's traveling? Jeff is traveling this week, so we pray for Jeff. Whenever we do People, of course, when we travel, literally, the moment you step out your door, you know, you don't have to go on a plane, because we need God's protection on our travel. So we pray. We pray for Jeff. Father, we thank you for Jeff. We thank you, Lord, that as he travels this week, we pray that you will give him traveling mercy. Watch over him. Protect him on his journey to and from, and indeed while he is there. We pray that you will keep him safe. And Lord, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray that you bring him back safely to us at the end of his journey. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So the Lord be with you. Amen. Yes, that's it. Let's stand. We're going to sing our final hymn. Our final hymn, which is a good rousing hymn to go out with. And let's dance. Let's dance. Teach me to dance. May we learn to dance to the beat of your heart. May we follow in your footsteps in the dance of life. May we love like you love. May we show compassion like you show compassion. May we care like you care. Lord, may we keep in step with your spirit in the dance of life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you and with all you love today, this week, and forever. Amen. One thing before we go, I do want to acknowledge Anne and Angela. They did the first week of the night shelter this past Thursday, yes? Yes. Yes. It is a work of sisters and brothers. It's a very worthy cause. There are lots of people sleeping rough, and we're trying to give them a night shelter with some food and a place to stay in the warmth and so on. So thank you to Angela. Thank you to Anne and Angela's daughter.
Katrina,
that's right, Katrina. And so it's not too late. Anybody else want to join and help out with the Forest Gate Night Shelter, please do see Angela. Thank you so much, Angela and Katrina. And so, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Have a blessed week, sisters and brothers.